Have you ever wondered just how powerful and destructive a tornado can be? How wide the funnel of swirling winds and debris could span? On May 4th, 2007, the residents of Greensburg, Kansas didn't have to wonder. They witnessed firsthand the terrifying reality of nature's most violent storms. A tornado of unprecedented size, nearly 2 miles across, slammed directly into the heart of their town, unleashing unimaginable devastation. This is the story of the widest tornado on record. Today we'll examine the atmospheric conditions that spawned this monster, retrace its path of devastation through Greensburg, and explore the aftermath and recovery efforts. To understand how a tornado of such epic proportions could form, we need to look at the broader weather pattern in place across the Central Plains on May 4th, 2007. Powerful, slow-moving, low-pressure system was anchored over the region, with an associated warm front draped northward into Nebraska and Missouri. This provided the first key ingredient, a focal point for the collision of warm, humid air surging northward from the Gulf of Mexico and dry desert air masses pushing in from the southwest. When air masses of contrasting temperatures and moisture content meet, the atmospheric instability required for explosive thunderstorm development is established. On this particular day, instability levels were off the charts, with CAPE values, which meteorologists use to quantify atmospheric instability, peaking at an extreme 5,500 JKG across parts of Kansas. In addition to astronomically high instability, wind speeds at different levels of the atmosphere became increasingly misaligned through the day. This vertical wind shear allows thunderstorms to develop a rotating, circular motion ideal for supercell formation and intensification. Radar imagery showed shear values more than sufficient for supercells to thrive. One final factor tied the hazardous weather setup together: the presence of a dry line over the southern high plains states. A dry line marks the boundary separating the warm, humid air mass from the hot, desert dry air. This incredibly sharp gradient in temperature and moisture acted as a compressional boundary, initiating widespread thunderstorm development by early evening. With a potent low providing broad lift, extreme instability established from dueling air masses, strong wind shear in place to inspire rotation, and a dry line serving as a spark, all the ingredients were in the atmospheric oven, just waiting to be unleashed by the day's intensifying heat. A perfect scenario was brewing for an outbreak of supercell thunderstorms capable of producing destructive winds, massive hail, and most ominously, violent long-track tornadoes. The Storm Prediction Center recognized the high risk that day.
So with the watches, the Storm Prediction Center in Norman, Oklahoma typically handles the severe
and issued alerts highlighting the potential for strong, long-track tornadoes across western Kansas and parts of adjacent states. But even the most experienced meteorologists could scarcely have anticipated just how powerful the setups would prove to be. Storms first began firing across western Oklahoma.
New this morning, Oklahoma is waking up to some storm damage. This video is from Tulsa.
And the eastern Texas panhandle during the late afternoon hours as temperatures soared into the mid to high 80s. One particular supercell thunderstorm quickly took on terrifying characteristics, rapidly intensifying and rotating violently as it drew strength from the rich atmospheric instability. By early evening, this fearsome storm had already produced a few isolated tornadoes across far western Oklahoma, but these twisters were merely a prelude to the devastating main event that was about to unfold in Kansas. Around 9:00 p.m. CDT, storm chasers and spotters tracking the supercell's every move reported the formation of a massive wedge tornado beginning to take shape south of the town of Greensburg. What started as a slender funnel cloud quickly metamorphosed into a multi-vortex monster, with multiple compact sub-vortices whirling violently around the outer edges of the large condensation funnel as it rapidly gained strength. Within just minutes, the now mature wedge tornado had explosively grown to over a half mile wide as it bore down on Greensburg, churning ominously northward on an unwavering track toward the unsuspecting town. The atmospheric conditions were tailored for disaster. High levels of wind shear, rich low-level moisture, and a stalling boundary providing constant lift allowed this monster to detach fully from its parent supercell and plow forward with fury. Bearing down on the south side of Greensburg, the massive wedge tornado showed no signs of stopping as it continued its expansion, engulfing more and more of the countryside with each passing moment. It reached its catastrophic peak width of nearly 1.7 miles, wider than the town itself, just before slamming into Greensburg's southern neighborhoods around 9 to 40 p.m. CDT. Several farmsteads unlucky enough to lie in the direct path were obliterated in the blink of an eye by the outer subvortices churning violently around the main funnel's periphery. Debris laced with boards, twisted farm machinery, and even entire trees was being violently lofted and cycled through the upper regions of the vortex as the tornado crossed over Highway 183. With little time to spare, the National Weather Service issued a dire tornado emergency warning for Greensburg, urging any residents who had not yet taken shelter to do so immediately, as this may be their only hope for survival. In the short span of just 5 miles, this once ordinary supercell had given birth to a nightmarish multiple vortex tornado spanning nearly 2 miles across. The tornado's sheer monstrous size made it virtually unstoppable as it crashed into the south side of town with incredible violence. Homes and businesses on the south side of town stood absolutely no chance as the tornado's outer subvortices began violently tearing through residential subdivisions. Entire rows of well-constructed houses were effortlessly swept away, their shattered remnants sitting across fields and roadways for blocks as if hit by a terrible explosive force. As the wedge tornado maintained its extreme intensity, plowing through central Greensburg, it leveled the Delmar Day Elementary School and obliterated numerous surrounding businesses and homes with incredibly violent winds rated as high as EF4. Downtown Greensburg was essentially erased from the landscape in a matter of moments, with City Hall, the historic Bigwell Visitors Center, storefronts, and churches all reduced to mere fields of rubble and debris. Greensburg High School fell victim next, as the tornado's core carved a path of tremendous high-end EF4 to EF5 damage directly through the center of town. One entire wing was flattened completely, its building materials and contents scattered by the extreme winds, while a nearly 5-ton reinforced concrete beam was pulled from the structure and thrown onto a parked vehicle nearby. The tornado maintained its terrifying broad size and extreme winds, fluctuating between EF4 and EF5 intensity, as it barreled through residential areas in northern Greensburg next. A large Mennonite church was leveled in this area, its foundation swept clean of debris and structures. Numerous homes were wiped entirely off their slabs, leaving only bare concrete pads behind. The incredible, violent power of this historic storm system was on full display. After chewing an exceptionally wide 1.7 mile path of destruction through nearly the entire town for over 22 miles, the wedge tornado finally began to gradually weaken and rope out as it exited the north side of Greensburg. While the violent tornadoes stole the headlines, the same powerful storm system also spawned a separate yet devastating flooding catastrophe that unfolded across the central North America. Two key meteorological factors exacerbated and worsened the widespread flood threat: the extremely slow movement of the system itself, allowing excessive rainfall to train over the same areas, and the repeated corridors of intense thunderstorms that continuously moved over the already saturated and primed regions. In eastern Nebraska and western Iowa, observed rainfall amounts from the persistent thunderstorms exceeded 6 inches, transforming fields and roads into raging rivers in a matter of hours. Further south in central and northeastern Kansas, communities were also destroyed with up to 5 to 6 inches of rainfall as the flood remained unrelenting. Further north, the states of North Dakota, southern Manitoba, and Saskatchewan were also not spared from the wrath of the flood, with widespread rainfall totals of 1 to 3 inches causing significant flash flooding issues from May 4th through the 7th. The overly saturated atmosphere and stubborn boundaries providing constant lift kept the thunderstorms training over the same areas night after night. In Topeka, Kansas, floodwaters rose so rapidly that numerous water rescues had to be carried out across the city to pull stranded residents to safety. In the Kansas City metro area, flooding was extreme as well, with many critical roadways closed to any attempting travel due to the high water levels. Across Missouri, levees failed along the bloated Missouri River, sending floodwaters pouring into hundreds of homes in the northwest and central portions of the state and prompting National Guard assistance. Some of the worst flooding seen since the historic Great Flood of 1993 was reported. In South Dakota, the city of Aberdeen was particularly hard hit, shattering its 24-hour May rainfall record with a staggering 7.75 inches falling in less than a day on May 5th-6th. Nearby, the town of Epiphany reportedly saw up to 10 inches from the relentless flood. The flooding was so extensive and impacts so extreme across Oklahoma that the governor declared a state of emergency for all 77 counties in the state. Strong straight-line winds caused additional damage on top of the flooding woes, downing trees and power lines, leaving over 11,000 homes temporarily without electricity amid the high water crisis. In the immediate aftermath, Greensburg was deemed too unsafe to remain occupied, leading to a full evacuation of the devastated town. The National Guard was called in to provide security and assist with recovery efforts, while the Red Cross and FEMA mobilized personnel and resources. Shelters were hastily established in nearby communities to house displaced residents, and rescuers scoured the rubble for survivors. Tragically, looting broke out amidst the chaos, leading to arrests and a strict curfew being imposed. When the dust finally settled in Greensburg, the scale of the catastrophe became apparent. An astonishing 95% of the town had been destroyed or severely damaged. 961 homes and businesses obliterated completely, with hundreds more impacted. 13 people tragically lost their lives, with over 60 injured by the tornado's fury. In the months and years that followed, Greensburg became a living case study in disaster recovery and sustainable urban planning. With 95% of structures damaged beyond repair, the town had an opportunity to rebuild essentially from scratch, with stringent building codes and renewable energy sources integrated into reconstruction efforts. Let me know your thoughts on this event down in the comments. Do you have any experiences with tornado or other violent twisters of this magnitude? As always, if you enjoyed learning about this historic tornado, make sure to subscribe and ring the bell to get notified about future uploads. Thanks for watching.